first of all, the reason that I think a lot of neurologists and psychiatrists are gravitating to a functional medicine approach finally after many years is realizing that the armamentarium of drugs, a single bullet, you know, philosophy or theory for depression or for schizophrenia, for bipolar, for autism, just is not helping. Treatment resistance is the norm, not the exception in psychiatry. The norm, not the exception. So I think the ability to understand that we need an integrative medicine approach that looks at dietary factors and lifestyle factors is critical for any specialty, but especially for people who are treating the brain. And just as an anecdote, I gave a lecture on the biochemistry of bipolar and autism years ago at a major university hospital, and asked some questions to the audience of residents and attendings about some fundamental aspects of glutamate biology. And I was really shocked that the lack of understanding about these pathways, which to me should be so basic that like a cardiologist understands, you know, circuitry of the heart. And I asked the chairman of psychiatry after the lecture, I said, why is it that nobody, you know, they had this deer in the headlights when I asked them questions about glutamate metabolism. He said, Jay, psychiatrists did not sign up to become neuroscientists. I was like, that's very surprising, because to me, if you're treating an organ system, you should know the organ system up or down and sideways, everything about them. The same way that a neurosurgeon goes in, takes a scalpel and understands that he's removing pathological tissue and not normal tissue. When we change the chemistry of a patient's brain in any way, we need to understand specifically exactly what we're doing and why we're doing it. I think we have to treat from the top down and the bottom up. The top down is really looking experientially, talking about the psychological factors that are going on, really communicating with our patients and being good listeners is absolutely critical. From the bottom up, what I personally recommend is looking at HPA axis vulnerability, whether it's genetic factors like MER-181 and FKBP5 and CRH1. These are all related to the cortisol translocation. Effects. I think they're very simple biomarkers that when people understand them and show them to patients really gives a higher rate of compliance when a doctor makes a recommendation about intervening with compounds that are MER-181 stimulators, for instance. I think that once we understand the relationship of that biomarker to the intervention and the response, it actually becomes very, very simple. It's not complicated at all. It's just really, you know, getting comfortable with looking at those biomarkers, understanding they're reflective of stress, resilience, vulnerability, and having the right armamentarium of tools to use for those patients, and then going back and actually asking patients longitudinally about the responses they get to those compounds. Practitioners who've never actually addressed stress disorders in a non-pharmaceutical way should get experience with some of the supplements that have been shown through a track record of having good experiential effects. Because once a patient reports back that this had a specific effect on themselves, I think the doctor will start learning more about that these are not just theoretical, that compounds like, you know, ashwagandha or rhodiola for stress truly have experiential effects, whether it's improving sleep or energy or metabolism or focusing. I think that I always tell doctors that and patients, the harshest critic or evaluation of a treatment is the response that you get. Listen to your patients. They will tell you what they need. More than anything else is asking them specifically, and just follow what they actually are telling you in regards to what they need for support in regards to nutrition or lifestyle changes. I think look at the foundation, which is genetics. Look at genetic expression, which are inflammatory markers. Look at the basics, which is insulin resistance and C-reactive protein as an inflammatory marker, and stick to the basics, essentially. So we know that, you know, for instance, vitamin D plays a key role in both the immune axis as well as the CNS. I think that we really want to build on, you know, going from a simple foundational approach, which looks at, you know, basic supplementation, to a more specific targeted approach based upon the unique genetic profile of patients that have really a need for individualized medicine, so that we're able to target those in a particular specific way. And one classic example of that is the APOE4 allele, risk factor for Alzheimer's disease. We really do know that treatment is different based upon the E4 allele, whether it's non-pharmaceutical or pharmaceutical. And I think that we're going to get much better at really understanding the connection between these nutritional supplements, whether they're adaptogens or neurotrophic factors or even basic dietary supplements, and understanding where they're applied in specific imbalances, whether it's in the immune system, the brain, or the cardiovascular system.